You're on the Virtual Entertainment Programming Network. TVEPN.com. TVEPN Studios, The Slam Show. And now, your host, Slam.
Yes, welcome everyone to another edition of The Slam Show. This is April Fool's, and I will not do any fucking stupid April Fool's jokes because it's been wore down left and right, and we're just going to go steady into the show with real shit. None of this freaking play around crap. All the play around stuff was on the pre-show, I think. Now we're ready to get down to some serious business. I, once again, will cater and orchestrate this incredible program that we always have on a Monday night. And as usual, I let my crew introduce themselves. Take it away.
I'm Lady Sage.
How you doing? I'm Manny Gavino, aka Manny G.
Oh, wait, just go ahead. Keep going.
DJ Stallion.
Karma.
Isis Love.
All right.
Hi.
This is my entire crew. Everyone is considered a co-host big time.
What's up?
I see, usually, Manny, we have all the co-hosts go straight into their introductions, but it's all good, man, because you took it like a pro.
He was like, I'm here.
Y'all don't understand. I'm excited to be here. It's been a long time coming. Man.
Bro, this is what it's going to be about, because we're going to go ahead and have a tremendous show. Lots to talk about. And as we always do, we have our week recap. And let's go ahead and rewind a bit with this past Tuesday, because a couple of things went on. But I'll go ahead and let my co-host DJ Stallion talk about his little Metreon at the San Francisco area. How'd that go?
It was cool, man. I did the event for that movie, The Host, that came out Friday, but he actually did a preview for it on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. Set up in the movie theater, played some music, and then dropped the soundtrack of the movie, the last like 20 minutes of it, and then St. John came in and then opened up the movie, did a little bit of a intro, and then that was it.
He actually like stood up on the stage and started talking about it?
Wasn't no stage, really. I'm just, you know, down there at the bottom. He just came up, gave him the mic, and it said, "Welcome, everyone. The host is from the person who did the Twilight, blah, blah, blah."
Right.
I blacked out after he said Twilight. and then the movie started. So then I had to, like, take my shit down in the dark.
In the dark?
It went straight into the movie. It was, like, no previews or nothing. It was something, like, just turn the lights off, and the movie started. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, it was, like, just weird scene. I'm like, what the fuck? Did I miss something?
Really?
Is this part two? What is this shit?
You're going, like, Star Wars, no credits, just freaking bam, the scene?
Bam, right into the scene, and they were talking, and stuff was happening.
So you DJed inside a movie theater, not the lobby.
No, in the theater. Okay. Yeah.
Shoot, you should have just, like, while the movie's going, just bam, into Chris Brown, just knocking it for the hell of it, dude. That would have been a trip.
I wanted to, like, play some sound effects and shit, but people were, like, too into it. So, I just tore down in the dark and shit, and then that was it.
You didn't use your, like, flashlight amp to kind of help you through, or what?
I didn't want to disturb anyone.
Yeah, I would have put on the freaking police siren amp where it's just blinking different colors and shit, just distract everyone. Fuck them. Why the hell would you have a DJ in a freaking movie theater? That's the thing. But, hey, it's a gig. I don't get it.
It's the people that do, like, all the different openings for the show. So they had, like, another preview across the way at another theater, too.
Is that a different movie?
Yeah, it was a different movie. It was G.I. Joe, I think.
You should have done that
I know.
One,
Which one did you sneak into?
I didn't sneak into any. I get in for free.
So you had a bear with watching that movie, right?
Just the 5 minutes of it took me to tear down.
Okay.
I was like trying to hurry up because it was like, this is weird. What the fuck's going on? You know, I was like, I guess they had a book out.
I could have told you that.
There was a book or something.
Mm-hmm.
And they all knew what was going on. So it was just weird.
Yeah.
Definitely.
That's what I heard. It was basically kind of like the Twilight theme, but aliens, correct? On that sort of relationship thing. That's what I was reading
I didn't get far that in the movie.
I was zeroed out.
I take it wasn't that type of tea for you, correct?
No, not at
all.
He
loved it, can you tell?
Oh, he was enthusiastic.
I was like, oh, hurry the fuck up. Watch G.I. Joe instead.
That's cool. hey, you got to be able to hang out with the moving family in St. John, so I can't complain.
Yeah, it was cool. Good to see him again, you know.
Cool, right on. And also that same Tuesday, our good friends, the Rocket Scientists, said, Slam, we need to talk about your history. Come on to our podcast and kind of break down who the hell you are and stuff like that. We ended up talking about, like, video games instead. It was pretty interesting. But much props to Solars and Goosey for putting together that podcast, and it should be airing possibly this week or next week. Just check on my Facebook for that update. And fast forwarding to Friday, great night over at Panetta's over in Pittsburgh. Yeah, Manny, there is a sports bar in Pittsburgh that's
really
popping.
Wow.
That's really popping.
And that's not guns popping, it's popping.
Slow down there, Stallion.
That's good to know.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Much props to Ron, the owner, Mike Sotero, and the whole crew for supporting the event. But yeah, that's what our past week looked like. Anyone wants to touch on theirs? Don't all speak at the same time.
My past week was your past week, so.
I was in Brentwood on Saturday at Grazie's.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that was pretty eventful, right?
It was cool, man. Yeah, it was a good crowd. I mean, it was pretty busy for, you know, Easter weekend, and then all of a sudden it was just like storming out like crazy. I could just see the raindrops were like big as pennies from the DJ's stage.
Right.
I was like, damn.
Made you want to go run out there and just start getting wet and come back in, right?
No, I'm cool.
Don't like getting wet.
Oh.
It's sad. Wow. For my past week, I have to like look in my calendar and see what I did because I don't remember things anymore.
Well, it's trying to remember. Was it
everything's like one big thing?
Was it a blur?
It's no. Let's see. Monday, train a client. Ate some ice cream.
Okay.
Did some cam
Rocky
shows.
Rocky Road?
Yeah, no. Did some cam Bubblegum shows.
It's it.
You know you're busy when you gotta put ice cream in the calendar.
Oh, let me tell you, I have to plan on my ice cream times and days because, like, my nutrition is super, super important to
That's me. What I was gonna point out, because you're on this regimen, you gotta fine tune that little.
And it was like sugar free, dairy free, no carb ice cream. And then
no
I was like, what
taste.
Am
That's
I going
to That's not real ice cream.
No carb, no
Isn't
taste.
Isn't that
it's
frozen
just,
yogurt?
It's real ice cream.
It was Froyo.
Yeah, it's
it was
Froyo.
Froyo.
Yeah.
Whatever happened to dryers?
Yeah.
Keep it real.
Dryer.
Start chewing on ice cubes or something.
And then I was with other people and they were like getting like candy corns and sprinkles and stuff on top of their ice cream. And they're like, what do you want? I was like, coconut shreds and almonds. But it was good. It was good ice cream.
Nice.
It was good stuff. But I really do have to like look in my calendar and see what I did. I trained a client.
Okay, well,
Tuesday,
we'll get back to you after Tuesday. Manny brings up his.
Tuesday went to the gym. Wednesday ate dinner. Thursday had DJ lessons.
Really?
That's cool.
Okay.
Yeah, and then Friday I trained a client also. So, hey, productive week of nothing.
Of miscellaneous duties.
Miscellaneous nothingness. Yeah, the most exciting part of my week for sure was DJ lessons. So.
All right. Fair enough.
Cool.
Manny?
No, I guess my week was pretty simple. Just
chilled.
Just taking one day at a time, you know, and got the call from you, and that made my week. I was ready to roll. Trust me, I was ready to roll.
Touch.
I was like, you know, but it's been a long time coming, man. I've been wanting to get on the show. I apologize for not being able to show up in the past. But first of all, I got to give straight props to you, man. Ever since I bounced out from L.A., you've been doing your thing. And much congratulations on all your success, kid. Really proud of you, man.
Thank you. Thank you, Manny.
Yeah,
and I can't wait till we go into your interview portion, because this gentleman has a lot of work that he's done. And if you want to go ahead and Google real quick Manny Gavino, then you'll kind of be prepared when we go into our interview later on in the show. All right, this week what we have coming up: Wednesday, Wild Wednesdays is starting over at Panetta's Sports Bar, as before mentioned. No cover, starts at 8 o'clock. Saturday we got a couple events, Stallion and I over doing a promotion with Macy's over in Concord and Hilltop Mall.
And
Richmond,
Southland too.
Southland as well. And be sure to come check us out. That's going to be in the early afternoons. Sunday, special event. And Sage also has a cool photo shoot. Can you touch base on that a little bit?
Absolutely. I have a photo shoot with Ready to Model magazine. We're actually preparing for the big MMA Expo happening on April 27th. So
yes.
Tune in.
Also, our affiliate, FONG Productions, is throwing their car show big time. Check out that. It's over in SAC. And for more information, just go to tvepn.com. You'll see the link on our front page. Click on that, and that'll lead you straight to the main page and also our Facebook information. It's all on there for what's happening. Mm-hmm. All right.
I'll be watching WrestleMania.
Okay.
Yeah.
WrestleMania.
Wait, yeah. Sunday?
Yeah, Sunday.
Well, that's pay-per-view day. What are you talking about?
That's pay-per-view day. 29 years, man. Come on.
Hey, there's also
Undertaker could actually have his streak broken.
And there's also some bad news. Ric Flair's son passed. Yeah, what was going on with that?
A couple days ago. Yeah, man. They found him in a hotel room in his hometown. And he had a past history of doing some drugs in like 2008 and 2009.
Wow, that's tough.
But I don't think they know the cause. There was no foul play yet. Ric Flair was actually in Japan when it happened.
That's tough. So
sounds really shitty, but anytime they find a body in a hotel and there's past drug use, I mean, one can only assume.
He was probably, you know, he's probably on some sort of painkillers, being that he was an up-and-coming wrestler.
Right.
Yeah.
So he's, you know, in the, you know, you're wrestling 365 days a year. You're every day you're banging up your body. So he was on probably something, probably drank a little something, and that was it. Went to sleep.
Yeah.
Never woke up.
Exactly. It's really tough, and I believe he was only 25.
Yeah, 25, yeah.
Wow.
Reed Flair.
That's too bad. That's too bad. All right, we're going to go ahead and take a quick commercial break and be back with the sports and entertainment segment here on The Slam Show. Everyone hang tight.
Here we go.
Business cards. Business cards. Business cards. Flyers. Flyers. Graphic design.
Graphic design.
Graphic design.
Marketing and advertising. Visit us at www.baymanda.com or give us a call at 650-571-5100. Baymanda offers 5,000 UV-coated club flyers starting at just $99.99. Place your orders today for rock-bottom prices at baymanda.com.
And now you know who's best.
If your child is not breathing, roll them onto their back. Check airway is not blocked. Gently tilt head back, hold nose and breathe twice into mouth. Place heel of hand in center of chest and push down 15 times. Repeat breathing and chest massage until help arrives. If your child is...
You know how to help your child if they've stopped breathing. But do you know how to help them if they have a drug problem? Visit drugfree.org for information, help, and advice. This message brought to you by the partnership at drugfree.org.
Quality never goes out of style. And the quality of the Paul Frederick White Pinpoint Oxford dress shirt at just $19.95 will make it the staple of your wardrobe. This special introductory offer won't last forever, so act now to get the quality, comfort, and style you can only get from the Paul Frederick White Pinpoint Oxford dress shirt. Order today and receive free monogramming, a $9.75 value. Go to 1995shirt.com and enter promo code COLLAR. That's 1995shirt.com, promo code COLLAR.
This season, take tailgating to the next level with Mr. and Mrs. T Mixers. Hand off some Bloody Mary mix in original, bold, and spicy, and premium blend varieties. Delivering true made-from-scratch taste with game day convenience. Mr. and Mrs. T Mixers promise perfect cocktails, even if the season isn't.
Goodyear presents awkward conversations between guys in cars.
So you admit you have tire amnesia?
Yes, I have tire amnesia.
Aha.
I do not remember what brand of tire I happen to have on my own car.
It's like you don't care.
Dude,
see, thing is, experts, people who really put their tires to the test, like NASCAR, they don't have tire amnesia.
But I'm not an
expert. Because NASCAR prefers Goodyear tires.
I'm not an expert.
Oh, and the first tires on the moon? Goodyears, chosen by NASA, heard of NASA?
Yes, will it make you happy if we pull over and see what kind of tires I have?
You don't have to. These Chevy Volts all come with Goodyear Fuel Max tires. They can help you save gas.
Wow, I have Goodyears?
Oh, so now you care.
Yes, I care. I care.
Goodyear, more driven. Receive up to $160 off with mail-in rebate when you buy 4 select Goodyear tires with your Goodyear credit card. Goodyear credit card purchases subject to credit approval. Certain conditions and restrictions apply. See retailer for complete details. Goodyear official tire of NASCAR. NASCAR is a registered trademark of the National Association for Stock Car Auto Racing Incorporated.
I tweeted all that stuff about that guy in the moment, you know? I never thought it'd be right there when you Googled him. I mean, it makes him look like, you know? Oh, I actually became a customer of his before he closed. Oh, man, the internet. You gotta stay on top of that thing.
On the internet, everyone is entitled to their opinion. Even this guy. That's why there's Reputation.com. Reputation.com understands that negative material about you online, no matter how untrue, could impact your reputation and your business. And you may never know the extent of the damage. Reputation.com helps you control how you look when people search you, managing reviews of your business, and pushing down misleading and malicious search results. Act now and get a free reputation assessment conducted by our expert advisors. Call us now at 800-283-1144. That's 800-283-1144. Or go to reputation.com.
Yes, welcome back to the Slam Show. This is the sports and entertainment segment. Yeah, we're kind of combining our two topics because we have a lot to talk about. Sponsored by Natural Light Foods. And strike first. First strike. Is it, which one is it, Sage?
Strike First Nutrition.
Thank you very much. Because it seems like it fits. Either way. It's, you know, backwards, forwards. Yeah, I'm not talking about
only
it.
Only when you're Googling it or like you want to go on the web and find a site, you have to do it the right way.
That's true. That's true. Thank you for the clarification, Stallion.
You're welcome.
We are going into our first topic, and this is a pretty interesting one. In recent times, various people over in the Ukraine and Russia are doing what they're now calling sky hanging. It's this new trend, kind of like a very extreme way of planking. Well, basically, I don't know what they're taking over in Russia or Ukraine, but people are going to the highest point with a video camera and doing these crazy-ass stunts, leaning over, just holding themselves with no safety net whatsoever, and just basically risking their lives just for a video. Guys, all right, we live in the U.S. We're kind of a little bit steady from some of the other places in other parts of the world. Do you think something like this is going to catch on where you're going to have people go up to freaking construction sites or even the Bay Bridge construction and just take a freaking video and just say, hey, I'm going to die, and at least they're going to catch it on film? Is this going to spread over here or what? Because it's big there.
I know I ain't doing it.
I'm scared of heights. Jackass, and they finally get it over there, and I go, "Oh, let's do this one."
Well, what's crazy is you're getting not only males doing it, females doing it, young kids doing it. Is there anything better to do over in that?
No,
part of
there's
the world?
Nothing better to do, and they're sober while they're doing it, which trips me out.
I can't even go 10 feet on a ladder.
isn't the drinking law?
Hey, Manny, right off. Can you swim?
I can swim. Yeah.
Okay. Good. Okay. Just want to get that out the way.
Oh, yeah, I can swim.
He can't swim.
Yeah. Thank you for busting me out there.
Well, that was a weird, odd question.
You know, it kind of reminds me of, you know, when people go rock climbing, but like free climbing.
Right.
You know, with no
harness?
Harness, no equipment. You know, they're completely with the hands. And I mean, it's kind of the same thing. So maybe the Russians and the Ukrainians are just late to the party, and they don't really have the mountains like we have. So there.
No, I think they got some big-ass mountains. Remember Rocky? He ran up that big-ass mountain.
Well, my take on it is that it's free. I mean, over here, the adrenaline junkies have to, like, jump out the plane and pay. Over there, it's free. That's what I think.
Okay,
They push you out, the mob over there, Russian mob.
Well, and out here, like, you can't really just climb up any building. There's security and trespassing and all kinds of stuff. So. Mm.
But you know you're going to have that person trying to sneak on and try to climb that.
You know, right. It's all about the YouTube video that comes along with it.
It's whatever could get viral.
Exactly. It is. It's a viral sensation.
Exactly. Whatever. Karma, you want to touch on this?
I think just the perfect point was this security out here. Remember, there was Spider-Man. What was that guy's name? I can't remember. I think he was Brazilian or something. He would free climb all the buildings. And then you get arrested, post his bail. Fucking 3 months later, all of a sudden you see him climbing up another fucking building. I mean, it's people are doing it. It's not to them. I think it's just shit. What is there to do? Let's go run around Chernobyl and get irradiated. No, seriously, go. Have you guys actually seen this site? You can actually go and take a tour of Chernobyl, and it's like $300. For a whole week.
To get cancer?
Basically.
Yeah.
What? You actually get the whole radiant badge. And also, oh, you pay the extra $500. You actually go to some places that, you know, probably are still very radiant.
The super awful, the super awful
Chernobyl
places.
Was in the drink in that movie, The Hot Tub Time Machine.
Exactly.
It was in that drink, energy drink.
I mean, that's like the quickest way to be sterile in your life. You don't want kids? Screw it.
Or you could have three penises walking out. Who knows?
You never know.
Hey, now.
God, imagine the kid that comes out of that.
Gosh, you could pay me enough money to go to Chernobyl just to even do that tour. Come on.
You know, it's been 20 years. You're all right.
Yeah, exactly. And it's supposed to be, what, 1,000 before it gets cleared out? The whole radiation.
Yeah, no.
Because it could be a tiny freaking particle, and that would just destroy you. You'll walk out there with freaking terminal cancer.
That stuff don't disintegrate?
Yeah. It's half-life.
There's worse tours around the world. Isn't there like one in China where there's all these dead bodies inside?
I'd rather go there.
Yeah, but it's dead bodies, not radiation.
I could do dead bodies all day.
Zombies will come out.
That's crazy. What now? But definitely no go here in the U.S. Skywalking.
I'll do it.
Ooh. Okay.
Okay. Next show, you're going to be jumping out the fucking
thing. No. We'll take the whole crew and we'll videotape it and...
I thought the whole point was to have this like that GoPro shit and just do it yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
As long as you're wearing a Slam Show shirt, it's all good.
There you go.
I get one of those
if
like.
We can identify your body. Oh, that's karma.
Yeah. I get one of those. Some guy jumped out of a plane in a Slam Show.
Heavy duty camera. Make sure the camera doesn't break when you fall.
EVPN.com. You can see the full video.
Make sure you just fall on your back. As long as the camera's okay.
You have to make sure the camera has a little parachute.
He was smoking on the way down.
Exactly.
You guys are too much. Yeah. All right. Moving on to our next topic, the Lingerie Football. Oh, I'm sorry. The Legends Football League. We had talked about that before. They had a name change. Has kicked off its fourth season. And yes, they do have United States teams this season. They after this name change, Sage, they went ahead and just reinstalled the LA Temptations and stuff like that. Brand new commercial that you're seeing right now. The usual thing, the name changes, but the freaking costumes are still nice.
Can we still call it the Lingerie Football?
That's what I
just
mean.
For this show.
That's what I want to call it.
Can we still call it the Lingerie?
I want to call it the Lingerie Football League.
I'd like to call it the Lingerie.
Okay.
Football
the
League.
Lingerie.
The Lingerie.
The Lingerie.
The Lingerie.
The Lingerie. The Lingerie Football League. How you doing?
So this is my gripe about it.
The Nightgown Football League.
For some reason, Manny, guys, they don't have one here in Northern fucking California. Not one in Frisco, not one in Sac.
So let's start one.
That's what I am saying.
Okay, who wants to be Northern California Lingerie
okay.
Football League?
Okay.
Because I will do it. I'm down. Who?
Hey!
Who wants to be?
I'll be head coach and you'll be my offensive coordinator. How's that?
Now, you know if you have tryouts. I'll be the defensive coordinator. You're in the offense. You see me play Madden.
Well, you know if you have tryouts. You know if you have tryouts, you know people are coming out for that.
Well, I will host the tryouts.
Well, let's go ahead and...
I will film the tryouts.
Okay.
We can do this.
All right, so...
This is a master plan.
Do we have a capital? Do we have money? I mean...
No, let's go ahead and put everyone in a position right now.
This is why we have Kickstarter.
That's right.
Thank you.
Kickstarter.
Sold. And I have investors. We're good.
I'll call plays from upstairs.
So we have ISIS.
I'll call plays from downstairs.
We have ISIS. What? What would your role be? Owner?
I would be the owner.
General manager. Okay, Manny, you'll be?
Offensive coordinator.
All right.
I'm calling plays from upstairs, though.
And Sage will be?
I'm fucking playing on the field, man. I want to be defense.
Oh, yes.
Wow. Sage, quarterback.
Right there.
Defense.
Sage is going to be my MVP, my star player. Right there.
Exactly.
Okay.
Run the pistol off.
And people already are saying they're going to donate to Kickstarter if we do this.
I'm telling you right now, I'm going to do this. I'm going to put it on my networks. I'm going to put it everywhere. You
franchise.
Think I'm lying?
What the hell is lining up right now?
I'm getting text messages. People want to do it.
I love it. I love it. Karma, what's your position?
69.
Only when I'm tired. I'll be a D coordinator. I won't be on the field. I won't be up close personal. Just, you know.
All right.
What are our
Come on, Vic Fangio. I like it.
Yeah, there you go. Not that old yet.
What are cheerleaders going to wear? We need cheerleaders. We need mascots. We need everything.
We don't need cheerleaders. The actual players are the cheerleaders.
Yeah, the girls that are not on the field are cheering.
I want cheerleaders wearing less than what the girls are wearing.
You mean pasties?
Pasties.
There you go.
Yes.
That'd be one great sight.
I want them to wear candy, and while the game is happening, they can eat the candy as we're winning.
Interesting.
Oh yeah, bars.
I broke my mic.
Interesting.
So it got too much. It got too hot.
Stallion, what's your role?
The announcer.
So you could go to all the games.
Yeah, and then you know I'll fix uniforms when needed. And,
I don't want you touching me.
And then ice.
I don't think you had to worry about him touching anything but himself.
And then we'll have a smokes free zone for karma.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
And the girls that need the ice, you know, when they're hot.
That's the thing I'm kind of frustrated because you have them on in every major metropolitan city except for San Francisco, Sacramento. What is wrong?
That just changed. No, that just changed. I'm telling you right now.
Okay, I'm with you. I'm just looking at the onset, why it hasn't been established, because this is the fourth season. 4 years, and they have not considered it.
I believe no one
They got a team in Southern Cal?
Yes. L.A. Temptations.
Wow.
But I believe that no one wants to share their fields over here. Like they don't want the college team, nor the pro NFL don't want to share the field with the
best field. You know, by far, Pac Bell Park.
Yeah,
that would be
it's
perfect.
Privately owned, so they need the money. I mean, they need the money because they're going to pay it off in 2 years.
Well, there's Candlestick when they kick everyone out of there.
They're going to blow that thing up.
That's a landmark. It's a landmark.
Oh, we got to find out when they do. Get some
O.co. O.co, everybody can take
Bart. eBay that shit.
We'll just do this shit at DVC. Right? DVC is perfect.
So we have our Hallmark Kickstarter, Isis Love, that's going to begin the new Northern California franchise of the Lingerie Football
League.
Lingerie. Legends Football
League. Lingerie, what are you, French?
Lingerie. That's French for Lingerie.
Exactly. All right, moving on to our final topic. We had some time this past weekend to watch a couple films, and I wanted to give my personal opinion, and I'm sure Sage will.
That's what we did. I forgot. Movie nights. I mean, started from Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Movie
whose
nights.
Films did you watch?
Manny's
or Isis?
Oh! We snuck those in a couple of times, but check it out.
Those genres might be the same at some point.
Three films. Three films in particular I wanted to point out. The one that you're watching here, the little trailer, is The Man with the Iron Fist. It is actually directed by RZA from the Wu-Tang Clan. And the two previous movies that we watched, by far, kick-ass. They are Flight and Skyfall, the James Bond one, and the one with Denzel Washington. By far, it's a must-see. I wanted to touch on The Man with the Iron Fist because it's one of those throwback type of films, sort of an indie-ish feel. RZA is his first directorial debut, putting out his thoughts and how he wants to have kung fu cinema on the big screen for today. There were some moments that it was like, okay, that's original, but there were some moments like, golly, it really shows how amateur of a director RZA is, and he plays the lead role in the film. Not knocking homeboy, all right? He's doing his grind. He's making it happen, man. You know how it is.
Boy,
he does not have the look to be a leading man. He looks sleepy, droopy. Looks like freaking Snoopy on screen.
Was he Bruce Leroy?
I know RZA.
Okay. Yeah. See, so much props, but leading man.
You just stopped right there. I know RZA.
Leading man.
Yeah, he looks like
Sammy got scared for a minute. He's like, ah, shit.
No, I'm being honest.
Not bad like that. I'll be honest.
Being very honest.
Hey, he was in the G.I. Joe, too, and he played, you know, kung fu style, whatever. I mean, that's his role. He just wants to play.
You guys remember, he's from the Wu-Tang Clan.
Yeah.
I mean, that, he
thank
was,
you.
That's, they set it up. I mean, that's what their whole thing was. That's what their Saturday was to watch old Chinese movies.
And he wanted to put that image on film. And
in his own way.
Yeah,
come on,
in his own way.
We grew up getting high and watching kung fu.
But overall, as a leading man, Sage, we were like, nah,
yeah,
this is,
to me, it was way below average.
Yeah.
The only part I liked was the whorehouse.
That's it. Yeah. Because the chicks, they become freaking like flying ninjas and shit. It was cool.
Are they naked?
Some scenes. It's rated R.
Yeah.
CGI blood and all that.
Yeah.
But yeah, he should have stayed behind the freaking scenes and just directed, got a different leading man, maybe you, Manny, to do it all the way.
It's hard to direct and acting in the same movie.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just direct to direct. You know, there's a whole skill behind that, you know.
Yeah.
And Kung Lee is in that movie, correct?
That's right.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah.
And he only said two words throughout the whole movie, two.
What did Batista say?
Oh, he had a lot more.
Yeah.
And if they would have got Bautista as Bane instead of Tom Hardy for Dark Knight Rises, it would have been totally a different freaking movie, because Dave Bautista, he looks the part of Bane, and he's up and coming because he's actually got casted for the Guardians of the Galaxy role, which is connected to Avengers 2. Ooh. Coming up in 2015 or 16.
Oh,
so, yeah, that guy, Dave Bautista, much props.
Yeah,
is he like the next Rock, don't you think?
Who knows?
He doesn't have the charisma as the Rock does, but he was wrestling for many years. He just started doing MMA the last couple of years. He won his last fight, his first fight, actually.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
So, yeah, he's you know, he's older, and he's been beaten up a lot. You know, his body, not beaten up like people knocking him out, but his body's been going through a lot, so... You know, he's just a late bloomer as in the acting thing.
Interesting. Yeah.
So maybe his moves will be beneficial for him in the future. Mm-hmm. His knowledge of them.
Yeah. So like I before mentioned, Flight, off the hook. Got to watch that. Skyfall, definitely off the hook. Has anyone seen those two movies?
Skyfall, yeah.
Okay. What'd you think of that?
It was all right. I mean, it wasn't like...
I like the whole origin aspect of it. So it's sort of a reboot toward the end.
Yeah,
of
and
the whole thing.
At the very end, it just got really like just drowned and slow. And there's like, you know, it's like wasn't exciting.
Really?
I don't know. I don't like really like that guy as James Bond. I don't know why.
Well, let's spin on something that you did watch this past weekend recently. G.I. Joe. How was that?
It was good, man. Saw it over there and actually watch it in the D-Box and 3D at the same time.
And how was my body double?
Which one?
What do you mean, which
Magic
one?
Mike?
Oh, thank you. Chen Tatum?
There you go.
I can't do that.
I don't know. One of them was your man, Chris. So.
Dude, you're flattering me. Keep going. So talk about the damn movie.
It was good, man. It was good. And definitely, you know, everyone thought, you know, someone was going to live, but then they died, and it was just weird. And they had a couple little mess-ups. If you were watching it, you saw, like, wait, he had a goatee.
God, 3 minutes later,
He didn't have a goatee. I was like, what the fuck? It's the same scene, right?
No, it was shot like 3 days later. He shaved.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Same fucking scene. It's like he turned around and then he's gone. It's like, what the fuck happened to that shit? I'm the only one that's seen that.
So he has a fast growing hair like Karma does. He could be freaking bald today, next week, full head of hair. It's there amazing.
Yeah, it was cool.
That's what.
That's some funny. And RZA was in it.
RZA again.
RZA's getting work.
Yeah, he did.
reasons like that are reasons I stopped going to the movies. It destroyed movies for me. Horrible. I can't even do it.
Well.
Ugh, God.
Oh, well. It's not for all. I mean, look at Karma. He hasn't been to the movies in how long?
20 years.
No, I actually want to watch these Smurfs.
Oh. Adult movies.
Yeah.
Which adult movies?
Oh.
I don't think they show that in theater, but okay.
No, it's
all right.
Let's go. Check this out. Speaking of adult movies, we have an extra topic to talk about. Former Yankees outfielder Hideki Amatsu is currently retired.
Matsui,
thank you. And he basically came out.
That was two different people.
Amatsu.
What the fuck?
I ate that last night. Damn it.
He came out in his GQ article that he has a adult DVD collection of 55,000 DVDs.
Yes.
55,000.
Kind of like yours.
Yeah, I was going to say, damn, you only have half of that.
He loves doing the shabu shabu, which is the dining on the naked women. Hopefully it's women.
We've done this, yes.
Yeah. So
most of the time it's sushi, yes.
I hope it's not curry, because that shit would burn.
Most of the time it's sushi.
Not to make it right.
A sushi or desserts, a lot of shabu shabu.
Well, check it out. In Japan, adult films, they're just like, collecting G.I. Joe figures. It's just, it's you just
common.
Could go walking down. Yeah, it's very common. You could walk in into like a Dave and Buster's and you'll see like porn-like video games and so forth. So,
but from what I understand, it's also different. Like they have to like blur the genitalia.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
So they'll have these like video games, but they'll blur that.
It's like, yeah,
it's blurred. Like they fuck up. They do the,
somebody
do the
correct
opposite.
Me if I, somebody, exactly. Honestly, correct me if I'm wrong, because this is really what I've heard, that like the Japanese porn, it's all this crazy pornography, except blurred. So it's the like same thing.
Really?
But blurred.
They need to blur the fucking face, so you don't recognize your like your uncle or your sister.
They blur
the private parts instead.
They blur the private
parts.
Weird.
Do you really want to know if that's your sister or not? I mean, that's what you're interested in.
I'm just saying. They need to blur her face out.
She looks familiar. I really think
I recognize that tattoo.
I know that mole.
Yeah.
Like, maybe they're blurring the cocks out because they're so small.
Yeah, maybe they're not really having sex.
How would you know, Stallion? You look down there.
Hey, it's Asians.
Lord. But well, they do some weird thing. I've seen some crazy Japanese porn where they've put on like nylons and then they fill the nylons with like goldfish or
what
or worms. Yeah.
What?
And they're like, oh. And they're having orgasms, you know, but you can't see anything. They're just, it's just weird. There's like, you know, animals in their pants. I'm sure out here it would be horrible out here because, you know, it violates, you know, a billion laws, mm-hmm. like bestiality, but it, you know, just goldfish.
So it's Cinemax at 1 o'clock in the morning.
Kind of blur it out.
But yeah, I watched it on, it was a documentary that I watched.
Oh, I thought it was one of your travels going to Japan or something.
No, I haven't been. I've only been to Brazil and Jamaica.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
All right.
Shot some stuff out there too.
So yeah. Hideki has a lot of free time on his hands, so he could catch up on all 55,000.
Well, I want to say that was hands. He has free time in his hands.
Do you think he's watched them all, or he just collects them?
Well,
I wonder.
Some people have a hobby.
Yeah, that's right.
He started a new Blockbuster. That's what in Japan. That's what he's doing. It's a new business venture.
Think about that. 55,000 adult DVDs.
What if there's any duplicates?
Something.
I want to know what his like niche is. Like, what's the fetish? Like, what does he like? Is it like 55,000 big boob DVDs? 55,000.
Doesn't he believe in downloads? He has a whole lot of freaking DVDs.
Doesn't he have
a lot of computers to buy.
Yeah, that's a lot of external hard drives.
He might just like the cover.
Yeah. That's right. But see, those are blurred too.
The covers?
Yeah.
Japanese.
That doesn't mean he's Japanese. He collects Japanese porn. I believe he has all types. So.
Well.
Did he say just Japanese porn? What's it say?
It's specific on Japanese.
Oh, okay.
Who knows?
Yeah. So Bin Laden.
Maybe he just keeps fucking buying them, hoping they'll all blur. He's like, fuck, this one's blurry. This one's blurry. Fuck, exactly. This one's blurry.
Maybe
all my DVDs are broken.
Maybe that's his fetish. Maybe he's like, blur. Oh,
blurry.
Yeah. Oh, look at that blurred out boobs. Yeah. Turn over. Let me see that blur.
Maybe he wants the imagination.
Yeah. Exactly. The girl's got some big bush.
Yeah, exactly.
He can imagine whatever he wants in that blur.
Yeah,
check it out.
Throw that DVD in. I love the imagination. Throw that DVD. I'm just going to close my eyes.
Well, check this out, guys. Let's use that blur in a very normal mainstream end. If you knew that you weren't going to show your genitalia or anything, they're going to blur it out. Does that make it an open-ended idea that you would do porn because you know you don't have to expose anything? Just have the action shown.
God, who knows? Maybe they're not even, like, maybe they're wearing, like, the pasty sling that, like,
exactly.
Holds everything down. You know, maybe
like
they're
said,
not even
Cinemax.
At least put a cartoon character face down there or some shit instead of a blur, like, Godzilla,
Hello Kitty.
Fucking yeah. Somebody.
There you go, Hello Kitty and Godzilla.
But then,
like, Pokemon.
Hello Kitty for the women. And shit moving his head.
Hello Kitty Pokemon. For the women, Godzilla for the guys.
Yeah. Make it fun and shit.
Moby Dick.
We're so wrong.
Oh, no, they kill the whales out there, man.
We're so wrong. Maybe he just likes that. Maybe he likes fish in the pantyhose. Who
That's
knows?
Right.
Never know.
You never
I think
know.
Just waiting for that blur to come out. Back in the day when you watch porn at HBO, it's blurry as shit at your friend's house.
He's got 20,000 balls of Windex
Damn,
in his
Stallion.
House and shit.
Watching porn at your friend's house.
Wiping down his TV. This shit won't go away.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Watch it here.
Wait. Stallion's talking about when you were younger and it would accidentally kind of come through in one of the stations and you would like
it's the same thing for him,
see glimpses of it.
I used to watch that.
You're like, you bang, bang, bang on the TV. Bang, bang. It'd be like, and then back to your like normal program.
That's right.
The cooking show.
As long as you get the going in.
Yeah, you climax. See like, the one squiggly line of porn.
Sam had that black box that everyone talked about.
Yeah, I got it from you. All right, we're going to go ahead and take a quick music break and be back with our special guest, Manny Covino, and talk about his acting career and what's going on with you. Stay tuned here on The Slam Show.
Yes, you could dance all night. By the end of the night, bet she land on pipe. I ain't talking about no plumbing, I'm talking about some loving. Yeah, I'm young, wild, and I'm thugging. Yeah, I do you right in public, and I know you'll do me back. Ooh, that's problem, yeah, he rap. Had you screaming, get the message, like I text you in all caps. Yeah, I kiss it all crazy, you'll be calling me daily. Like my first name is Carson, out this world like a Martian. Cause I got booyah, 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 booyah. Blow, 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 blow. When I'm done, can you stay? I'm like, no, 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 gotta go, go. See ya, girl, girl, get from me. From that pole's calling your name, name. It's time to get that money.
If the beat's alright, she will dance all night. If the beat's alright, she will dance all night. If the beat's alright, she will dance all night. She will dance all night, all night.
Ay, 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 her cha-cha ain't got no limits. I'm out here smoking my spinach. She'll bust it down in a minute before I finish my sentence. If it ain't white, it ain't right. If it ain't black, take it back. If it ain't brown, I ain't down. That's why we all gon' get down. Cause I can feel it coming out these speakers, surrounded by these chicas. She sexy, fine, freaky, zodiac sign. What you know about them Libras? She don't do the hokey pokey. She sip, drink, and get smoking. She'll dance all through the noche, trying to function like E-40.
If the beat's alright, she will dance all night. If the beat's alright, she will dance.
Her partners ain't no punks, they bad and never scared to get ratchet. The rubber bands ain't lacking, the DJ got it smacking. Lights on, lights off, cause we the main attraction. Yeah, her birthday cake is clapping, clapping, clapping. Her birthday cake is clapping. What's happening? What's happening? That red bone to that yellow, somebody grab an umbrella. My music makes her wetter.
The nastier the better. If the beat's alright, she will dance all night. If the beat's alright, she will dance.
Yeah, that's brand new Baby Bash featuring Problem Dance All Night.
Mm-hmm.
I love those lyrics. Very yeah, positive.
And the hook of a Chris Rock.
Yeah, it is Chris Rock.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go. There you go. And who is that actually from?
BPMSupreme.com for all those DJs out there that want to be in a record pool. It's $19.99 a month. Unlimited downloads. You can sit there all day and download everything on the whole site. Videos as well. Intros, remixes, acapellas, and everything else.
Good stuff, good stuff. All right. Welcome, everyone, back. Right now, we're going to go ahead and have our exclusive interview segment. And I'll have a little video thrown up by the gentleman that's in studio. He is a Pittsburgh native, traveled over to L.A. for the Hollywood Dream. And that was back in the early days. He's been in a lot of films. He's been on TV. If you remember the show Jag, this clip here is from a movie he did called Harrison Montgomery. And he is actually a good friend of mine. Let's have a big round of applause for Manny Gavino.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for having me, Sam. Thank you.
You're welcome. Let's get right into it, man. You're an actor, working,
yes,
trying to keep busy and stuff like that. I know you. Talk to our audience and viewers out there about who you are, what you're about when it comes down to this whole industry that you're trying to get a career started in.
Basically, just trying to keep it real. And acting is something that fuels me. I can't see myself doing anything else, you know, whether it be working in a bank. Not to degrade that.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
great for someone else, but for me to work a Monday through Friday, a 9 to 5, that ain't me, you
mm-hmm.
know. Other than if I was if I was working on a series, yeah. But to have to do like a regular job where I'm sitting at sitting in some cubicle, I'd go crazy, you know. I'd probably kill myself, you know. That's just not me, you know. In life you have a calling, and this is what
I was meant to do, you know, as far as pleasing myself. And, you know, you always want to do things that make you happy, and, you know, you want to be happy doing it, and it's great to be doing it, especially, you know, you're successful at it. Mm-hmm. Just like, you know, what you do, you know, you're great at what you do. I'm sure you couldn't see yourself doing anything else. You know, that's just how I feel. And as for me, right now, I'm in a great place, you know, but to the day they put me in a box, until I go 6 feet deep, you know, I'm not giving up on my talent.
That sounds like a movie title right there.
You know, this is who I am, and I'm going to just keep plugging away. You know, and at the end of the day, when I'm 70, 80 years old, even hopefully still be doing it by then,
mm-hmm.
you know, I could look back and go, you know what? I gave it my best, and this is what happened.
Yeah, like what your co-host, the one that was the main lead actor in Harrison Montgomery, Martin Landau?
Martin Landau, yeah.
Yeah, gosh, he's like, what, 80-something?
He's up there. He's up there, but, you know.
That's a veteran for you.
No, it was definitely great working on that set, simply for the fact that, you know, we were hanging out, just, you know, getting ready for the day, and he was telling me stories, and it was great to hear all these stories when he first, you know, came up.
Right.
And even when he started becoming successful, you know, he told me all these great stories, you know, about him and Liz Taylor. And I'm like, wow.
Liz Taylor.
Yeah.
You got any gossip to share with our viewers that he said?
he gave me some great stories, you know, but, you know, she's a trooper, you know, and he said just to work with her and to be in her presence was, you know, the greatest.
That's cool.
You know, and everything he told me, I just took it in. You know, and just listen.
Yeah.
Just listen, you know.
Just having someone that you could actually look up to, knowing he's a veteran in the entire industry and still working at that advanced age is pretty incredible. So let's kind of back up. I know you from your JAG days when you were working on that. If you just Google JAG or YouTube it, you'll see a whole bunch of the episodes and so forth. But, yeah, that was pretty significant because it was something that kept you busy for a little bit, right?
That actually that JAG episode, or when I booked JAG, that was pretty special for me. You know, that was my first breakthrough television role.
Right.
It was huge. And I think what also made it great was I actually got to play a Filipino. You know, I remember, you know, going to the first call, producer's call, then the third last call. And I guess the team was skeptical as far as the producers and everybody.
Oh, really?
Because they didn't want to hire me. They called my agents and asked me, well, what's his background? And they were like, he's Filipino. And they were like, well, he don't look Filipino. And well, what does that mean? You know,
brother, I get that all the damn
exactly,
time.
Exactly. You know, and my agent called me back and I went, come on, man. I said, dude, do what you got to do. Fucking fight for me. Fight for me, man.
That's what just agents should.
Say, yeah. So tell him I'm Filipino. Don't get no Filipino than me.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I am a little bit taller than most, but, you know, don't let the outer exterior fool you. I mean, I got it. I can do this.
Right.
You know, but eventually it worked out, and it was great. And thanks to JAG, I was able to buy my wife her wedding ring.
Oh, there
yeah.
you go.
Yeah.
Good man.
It was the right time.
You didn't blow it on a Ferrari or anything like that, huh?
You know what? I'm not going to lie, and maybe my wife is listening out there. I remember that very day. It was a Saturday, and I was coming from the gym, and the mail was there. And I'm like, please be there. Please be there. Because it's already been like a week or so, and I had worked on JAG for about, I think, a week, almost a week,
mm-hmm.
you know.
You did the money prayer. Money,
yeah.
Money.
So I opened it up, and I saw CVS. I went, yes. And I looked, and I went, this is what it's about. You know, to get paid
doing what
that
you do.
Amount.
Yeah.
To do what we do, to do something, exactly,
yeah.
To do something you love and get paid, it's the greatest, you know, and trust me, I wanted to splurge,
you know,
I wanted to go buy my Timberlands and all my all my other gear, but I'm like, you know what, I gotta do something special for this lady that I love.
Aww.
You know, I gotta buy her something.
Good man.
Yeah.
So let's talk about that whole situation being Filipino. It's a very rare commodity in Hollywood right now for any Asian to get a prominent role. Why do you think that's a struggle, especially in the Filipino community, to have mainstream work? Because I don't recall any other Filipino getting that type of sitcom or TV show on any level So what the hell's going on with Hollywood?
It's a tough gig. You know, to be honest with you, I don't have an answer for that. I don't. You know, it's just that door is still closed. That door is still closed, even though, you know, there's been a few here and there. You know, straight props to the Boscos. You know, they're doing their thing. You know, that they're probably the closest thing right now.
Rufio!
Yeah, exactly, that we have out there. You know, there might be a few here and there, but, you know, that door, it's ready to be kicked down. And, you know, if it ain't someone else, I hope it's me. Cause,
start kicking those doors, Manny.
I'm trying. You know, I think of myself as a leading man, you know. Good. I may not be alive at the end of the movie, but... You know, definitely, you know, I think of myself as a leading man, you
well,
know.
Way better than RZA.
You know, you know, those 13.
Sam's asking for it.
Yeah. You know, those 13, 14 years that I put in, you know, I can't give up. I've come too far, man. You know, I ain't, no matter what anyone says, you know, I'm going to keep living the dream and keep doing my thing. And
definitely.
Like I said, at the end of the day, I gave it my all.
That's cool. So let's talk about your most proudest role. What would that be? Throughout your entire acting career?
If I could say right now, it probably wasn't anything TV or film. It was probably a theater play. It's probably a theater play called Short Eyes by the late Puerto Rican poet Miguel Pinheiro, which Benjamin Bratt, he played Miguel Pinheiro. But actually, Miguel Pinheiro, he wrote a play called Short Eyes, and it takes place in prison. And it's a play that comes from, I believe, the mid-70s. And if you watch the movie Short Eyes, you'll see young Luis Guzman. He's in that movie. And it was pretty deep for me, because you know, all the stuff that goes on in prison, you know, it's not a pretty place to be.
Can I ask why it had such an effect on you, or why it was so important to you?
All the research I did for this, you know, even though this is close to some of the roles that I play, I wanted to go deep and real deep into this character. And especially, you know, like when you're in prison, you know, as far as guys, you know, you definitely, you're looking to get off, you know, and taking another man's manhood, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not about homosexuality. It's all about, you know, you wanting to get off and you making somebody else, I guess, your bitch, you know. And there's this one scene in the play where it's a shower scene.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all the guys leave, and, you know, basically the character's name is Cupcakes. So basically, I do everything I can to take his manhood in the shower.
Mm.
You know, and it's a struggle. It was a bit of a struggle. And I was telling the other actor, I go, dude, whatever you do, do not let go of this towel. Because if this towel comes off, I have no other choice to do it. Exactly, you know.
Yeah.
And we're on a stage, you know. It could happen. I said, dude, you better hold on to that towel for dear life, because I'm going for it. And the character that played Cupcakes, I went so deep with this character that I was having thoughts of him.
Mm-hmm.
Even when the play was over.
Yeah.
I mean, I was, you know, it may
you
sound
were deep into character.
Yeah, I was like having dreams of him, you know. Which sounds kind of off, but that's what happens when you go, you know, you scratch the surface as far as trying to break down a character.
Yeah, and it's method all the way.
Yeah,
method acting.
Straight method acting, you know. So that was rough, but, you know, it definitely, I feel proud of that role.
Okay.
And like I was telling you earlier, I was so taken in by this role that I couldn't watch anything else that was, like, deep and dark. I was watching, like, Friends, like, 24 hours nonstop, you know, straight laughter. You know, so that's how that I feel proud about that role.
You're trying to balance yourself out.
Exactly.
That's pretty impressive that you could be very transparent with that role and say to our viewers and everyone listening that was the best role I had, even though it could be sort of uncomfortable.
Freaky.
Yeah. I mean, I was walking around L.A. I'm surprised I didn't get thrown in jail or something. Just
stuck in that role.
Yeah, I was just walking around angry.
Right.
You know, so, but...
Well, that shows how much you're inclined to go into the character without any reservations. And that's a good thing. And I think that should be able to let your agent know and others out there that, hey, you're a very great actor to encompass that.
Thank you. Thank you.
So let's go ahead and roll to my co-host if you have any questions for Manny and kind of touch on that for a little bit.
If you weren't doing acting, what would your 9-to-5 job be, since you said that you cannot stand to be a regular 9-to-5er and doing, you know, normal jobs? But that, what would that be?
I think probably coaching kids.
Nice.
You know, coaching football. LFL. You know, before I left for LA, you know, I was coaching JFL.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, working with the kids, you know, that was something cool. And you never know, I might have gotten that itch to probably coach at the high school level. You know, but other than if I didn't become an actor, probably coaching.
Nice.
Yeah.
You're definitely going to coach the Lingerie Football League franchise.
I'd love to. Start. Yeah.
The Legends Football League. Come on now. Let's be proper about it. Legends Football League.
Thank you.
It's Lingerie.
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 I have a question.
Sure.
What inspired you to start acting? What was that moment where you were like, this is what I'm going to do. This is what I'm going to be, and I'm going to go for it.
I think it all started with breakdancing. And actually, I think at the time when I was still living in Pittsburgh, you know, I just didn't have any direction, what I was doing, didn't know what I wanted to do. I was going to school, was dropping classes, was playing football. So Dante Bosco was shooting a movie. He was shooting Rufio. Or he's shooting Hook. He's playing the character Rufio.
Yeah, correct.
And, you know, we'd always keep in contact even when they went to L.A. I was still living in Pittsburgh. And they said, come on down. I'm shooting this movie. And I was like, all right, cool. So, you know, went on down to L.A. and was on, I think it was a Warner Brothers set. And he was shooting Hook. And I was like, wow, man, this is cool. You know? Because they always asked, you know, my Auntie Ida, which is Dante's mom, she always asked me to come down and say, you know, maybe if you want to get into acting. I was like, nah, that's not me. But then I think that's when I got bit by the bug.
Mm.
You know, I was like,
I could do this.
I think I can do this.
Did you see it? It was like larger than life. And you're like,
oh, yeah. I mean,
I was like, he looked at Dante's paycheck and said, I'm going to start doing this shit.
No, you know, it was a funny thing because, you know, Dante was working on his stuff, you know. To the left, you saw Julia Roberts. To the right, you saw Dustin Hoffman. Mm-hmm. You know, over there was Bob Hoskins. And now I'm just going, man.
Robin Williams.
Yeah, and Robin Williams. And I'm like, man, this is cool, man. So
I want to get a director's chair. Or you know, what's it called? The chair?
Director's chair.
Yeah.
Director's chair.
What's it called?
But you know what?
I have five of them. I'll bring you one.
Please.
But you know what? Even after moving to L.A., you know, I was like, because a lot of people come to L.A., they want to become an actor. They get caught up in this acting thing, you know, but there's more that comes with it. So, you know, I actually, over the years that I studied, when I first started studying acting, I actually got a respect for it.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Totally got a respect for it, where it's more than just what you see on TV, all the limelights, you know, it's an art form, you know, you have to own your craft. And I definitely got mad respect for what I do.
Were you like at home in the mirror all the time going, you.
I was. I was looking in the mirror going, winking to myself. And,
yeah, you have
you
to.
Know, you're fooling yourself.
Yeah.
You're fooling yourself, but then you come to learn the harsh reality of it.
Well, yeah. I mean, like, you do the same line, like, 20 different times, like, to try to get it, like, 20 different ways.
That's me before an audition in the bathroom.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm a mess. Mm-hmm. You know, but once I go in that room, I got to ground myself and just try to do my thing.
That's good insight. That's good insight. Guys?
Who is your favorite female actor and your favorite male actor?
Wow. Tupac. There's a few. You know what? Pac is one of my mentors. He's one of my inspirations, actually. So, but if it were someone, can I name two male actors?
Sure.
Yeah.
Marlon Brando.
Ooh.
Paul Newman.
Ooh. Nice.
Okay.
Female.
Isis Love.
Shut up.
She's on that list.
Yeah. I have played multiple characters, thank you.
Wow, female. Liz Taylor.
Going way back. All right.
And I'm going to go current because I'd love to work with her.
Vanessa Hudgens.
Shut up.
Bastos.
Jennifer Lopez.
Really?
Really?
I'd love to work with her.
As an actress?
As an actress?
Yeah.
As an actress,
As a singer?
I just would love to work with her.
So current.
But
why her though? That's a very interesting
a love
scene. That just blew me out of the water.
I think
because she's not really known for her acting skills.
I know, but
I think known for Selena.
We'd look good on screen together.
It's a match thing.
It's a match thing.
Okay,
you know,
it makes sense.
Remember, but I will before I'm thinking right now. There is a female actress that I do her work. I do love.
Who?
I'm going in the Rolodex right now.
Okay.
There's a lot of them. Probably.
Can I tell you mine? Just because.
Go ahead.
First of all, I just watched. What the hell did we watch? The Snow White and the Huntsman.
Oh, I love that movie.
Oh, Twilight Girl.
Yeah. No, I do not like the Twilight Girl, but Charlize.
Oh, Theron.
Theron.
Oh,
that's why I love
Charlize Theron. She was badass.
Holy.
Devil's Advocate.
Fuck. Yeah. I fucking love her.
Every woman wants to be with her. They'll go gay.
I love her. I love her in that movie. I love her in Monster. I love her in.
She was in Prometheus as well.
Prometheus. I love her in everything.
Hancock.
That's
right.
She was the superheroes.
And the reason I like her so much is because she is not a typecasted actress.
True.
She does not stick to one genre of acting, and she can cover all bases, and she's fucking amazing, and she can be the ugliest thing from Monster to the most amazing.
Oh yeah, she does great work.
Man, I have like a whole newfound respect for her after last night.
So Manny, how about her up there?
You do it.
Okay. Could but anything anyone specific female? Still on that Rolodex?
Still in the Rolodex. There's a lot. I mean, I gotta give the name I give is she's gonna be dope.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, maybe after Karma's question.
Okay.
It's my turn now.
Yeah.
Just making sure. You don't have the name in your mind yet?
No, not yet.
Oh, okay. Because I'm trying to remember my question now. It's been a minute. Actually, we were talking about earlier the method acting.
Uh huh.
Is there a role that? Like, actually, it's a good thing that you guys just touched on was with, like, Charlize Theron. So, being able to play so many roles, but not being able to be typecast. So, you have, like, Robert De Niro is very respected, but you always, you know, kind of have that surly.
Yeah.
Even this comedian, he's kind of like the dark, hard, tough guy. Al Pacino has got to have the big yelling thing. Samuel Jackson's got to yell. I mean, he's different characters.
Sticks on the plate.
Exactly. Exactly.
Nicolas Cage is the same way. I can't watch any Nicolas Cage movies because I'm like, oh, this is like a sequel to the last one I watched.
So as far as method acting, if someone comes with you with a certain role, you're thinking, you know what, I might get typecast having to do this. Would you actually turn that down? Would you actually double think, like, maybe, in other words, would you like creative play within your character? Put it that way.
You know what, as far as playing the roles that I've played, you know, I've been typecast. So I definitely would try to reach deep underneath the surface, because there's always more you can scratch. There's always more you can do, you know. But it'd have to make sense for me. I'd have to get something out of it, you know. Because if I already been there, done that, I'd just go, you know what? I can't do it no more.
Now, have you ever had like a side role, within a, say, either a TV show like JAG or something like that, or a movie where you just know you're a bit player, where you say, okay, I'll just do my line, get it out of there, or do you always feel like, okay, no matter what, I'm going to give it my all. If it's two lines, if it's three scenes, if it's
a whole
damn movie, you know,
I'd have to think about it. No, I just have to go, okay, well, what am I going to get out of this? You know, but then again, on the flip side of it, I have to think of my family, you know, because I got to make some money.
Yeah.
You know, I got to put food on the table and all that. But I think if there was a role that I can probably get out of this typecast that people would look and go, ooh, he can do other things.
Right.
I'd love to do The King and I.
The King and I.
Okay.
Well, you have the head for it.
Yeah. All you gotta do is cover up my tats. You know,
that's right.
Airbrush.
Exactly. I'd love to do The King and I. You know.
You know that was banned in Thailand, right?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, they made fun of the King.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's a great question you brought up, Karma, because, like, for example, Denzel Washington. No matter what role he plays, he'll play that character, but then there's that Denzel-ish charisma that he brings to every single one. That way he doesn't have like this stereotypical method acting for that particular role. It's Denzel, but his flavor.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. I think you know, that's a good point. That's the perfect word, flavor.
Yeah.
Like Denzel, like I said, Samuel Jackson has to yell, has to scream.
Yeah.
Denzel, I mean, with Denzel had this one intense moment, you know, that he's trying to make his point.
Exactly. Yeah. With each character that you play, there's always a part of you that right. you could put in that character. There's correct. Always something of who you are that you can always put into each and every character.
Yeah, and I think it's about the actor or actress's range to be able right. to yeah. encompass that particular character, because let's go back to the RZA leading man for The Man with the Iron Fist. Yeah, he's the one that calls all the shots, but was it a very wise choice to have him being that leading role, knowing that he didn't have enough range or charisma to handle that, to bring more into that lead part? That's the thing that I'm questioning. So the director, the producers have to know right off the bat if they're going to say, hey, Manny, you look like the right guy for the leading role in this film. Let's have you bring you.
Right.
Improv sometimes. Follow the script, but be you. That's where I think brings out the best out of each actor right. and actress.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And definitely.
Totally agree.
So to roll over to Isis real quick, do you share that same understanding where it comes down to females having to encompass some of who they are versus what the role's asking?
Definitely. You have to put a little bit of your heart into it, yourself into it. Otherwise, it's just mechanical, honestly. And I feel like you can see it. You can tell. You know, you're not 100% into it. You know what? Do you remember District 9, the movie, like yes. years and years ago?
Yeah, okay. The one with the cool the aliens.
Yeah. I am not a huge fan of alien movies at all. District 9 was one of my favorite movies for a very, very long time. And it was mostly because they didn't cast these people that I knew that I've seen in all these other movies, and how it was shot. And it was shot in a way where I was like, this is real.
Yeah, yeah, the dynamic of it.
The dynamic and how, I don't know the actor's name, but it was just, he was amazing.
I still don't.
they're all from South. Oh, it was all about South African. That's yeah. why. These actors we never see. Of course I did. Yeah.
And
it's a great movie.
But
it's
that's
a
why
movie.
I loved it. I honestly think if they would have, right? I think if they would have casted somebody in that role that I would have seen in another movie a billion times, it wouldn't have been the same experience for
I agree.
Me at all. And that's what I was saying, like about Nicolas Cage, or about this motherfucking snakes on this motherfucking plane.
Yeah, Samuel
you know,
Jackson,
Samuel
yeah.
Jackson. Like every time I see Samuel Jackson, I'm like, people that I love. I love Morgan Freeman.
Yeah.
Love Morgan yeah. Freeman. He's very consistent in the roles that he plays, but he has this kind of like whimsical,
distinguished
yeah,
uncle feel.
He's God. I mean, think about that. He's God and Bruce Almighty.
This new one that
Tom Cruise has. He's like,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I'm the guy who's going to reveal the truth. I am the truth, and I'm going
to
reveal
him.
The truth.
I swear to you, no lie, no joke, I have like daddy issues with him. Like, that's my father. Like, when he's talking, I'm like, okay, yes, Dad. Like, it's very strange.
Respect.
I have so much respect for him, you know, and but he's one of the only like kind of method actor or those typecasted actors that I like.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of them, I'm just like, I could care less. Although I watched a movie the other day with Rusty. I can't even remember what it was called. Rock of Ages.
That's the one with Tom Cruise, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Isn't that a musical? That
yes, yeah. It's a musical yeah. with Tom Cruise in it. There's a ton of people in it, and I was like, kind of in shock because you know we were all sitting around, and my family was like, "Let's watch a movie, Rock of Ages." I'm like, "Okay," and I was like, "Oh God, this is a musical. Great."
Yeah.
And then I was like, "Oh, that's funny. Oh, that's funny. Oh, holy shit, that's Tom Cruise. Holy fuck." So I mean, I like that people can change it up, and I like being shocked and surprised and to be able to look at a character who I know, who I've seen a billion times over.
Still be refreshing.
But yeah, but see right. them as that character and not as themselves. I like Jennifer Connelly for that reason. She mm-hmm. was everywhere from The Labyrinth to Requiem for a Dream.
Or The Hulk.
She's like, but she's like everywhere, you know? And,
yeah.
And I appreciate that about her acting, and I much prefer that.
Yeah. I think across the board, acting is very much a very precise art, because if you don't get it right, it destroys the whole film, destroys all the millions of dollars invested yeah. into it. And
especially
if
you're doing theater.
Yeah, because you got one shot.
It's right there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whereas film and TV, Cut. One take, cut. Two take.
Yeah.
All right, back to one.
It'll be like Terrence exactly. Howard in Iron Man. Yeah. This is like the 25th take.
But you know what? There's one thing. For every director that I work for, before I start working, I pull them aside and I say, look, if I don't give you what you want, let me know. I don't want you to move on until you get what you want out of me.
Good.
Okay.
Okay. Good. Whether it's one take, whether it's five, whether it's 10. If you know we can't do that many takes, just pull me aside and say, look, I don't know what you need to do, but you're not giving it to me right now.
Right.
And I'll say, okay, I'll do my best to give it to you, but do not move on until we get it right.
Wow.
Good. So,
straight up.
Straight up.
And I'm that director straight that's up. Like, nope, do it again. Yeah. Nope, do it again. Cut, yeah. do it again. Hold on, let me show you how I want it to get to be done. And I'll go and do the whole scene and then right. say, do it like that. I'm an asshole.
Hey.
No, actually, that's
what
great.
You have to do to get the shot.
Well, that's actually a great thing. We have a director and an actor here. That how would that relationship work as far as director and actor? Does an actor actually get so frustrated after times? Like, look, just tell me what the fuck do you want me to feel? You know, do you want me to fucking frown here? Do you want me to yell?
Most of the directors that I've worked for.
Well, in the script, it says scrowling yeah. or frowning. Yeah,
but
and I mean, like
but you know, the director a lot of times wants a certain when I see angle my script. And stuff like that. Sometimes it's kind of like you know as stupid as it sounds, we make fun of it. It's like, okay, what's the motivation? It's really is that okay? Where? Because remember, you don't see it a good movie. You're not going to think about okay, this guy isn't really running from an alien, scared as shit, trying to save a kid.
Yeah.
It's you know 2 seconds. Okay, cut. Okay, now you're doing this. Cut. You know, and he's got to keep that kind of emotion to that scene.
True.
So the good director, I'm sure, is going to tell you, okay, this is what's going on, and I'm just kind of seeing how forward they are, or is it more like, okay,
there's
do it this way, let's do it a few times.
Crazy directors out there. There's some really crazy directors out there that where, you know, it's like, you do it one way, and that's not how they want it. You do it another way, that's not how they want it.
Like, what the fuck? Make up your mind.
So then after three takes, I got to be like, okay, well, excuse me. I'm like, well, what do you want? Tell me what you want, and I'll deliver it. I'll try my best. You know, but for the most part, I haven't had, you know, any run-ins with any directors as far as it turning really bad, as far as the relationship between actor and director, director yeah. and actor.
Gotcha.
So. I want to sneak in a quick question. I know acting is all about memorizing your role. God forbid you forgot, like you just like totally blank out. Can you improv and like, you know, let's do it my way.
Then the director saying, that's great!
And get away with it and correct and say, you know what, that works. Have you ever done that?
Sometimes, yeah. Actually, the worst thing you could do when they're filming is you cut yourself.
Yeah.
You go, no, stop. What I usually where like let's say a line drops, I start to improv.
Right.
You know, I start to do my thing. When he calls cut, then I can go, all right. But there's been times where I just like for some reason I drew a blank as far as my lines.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but here's the funny thing. I was terrible in school. But you asked me to I found a niche where I can memorize lines.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Yeah,
like if I had to be on set tomorrow and memorize like 3-4 pages of dialogue, I'll be ready by 7 o'clock call time.
That's incredible, isn't it?
But I suck in school. For real, I did. I was terrible in school.
No, because I remember taking drama in high school, and you're supposed to like memorize a monologue, and for the life of me, I couldn't memorize the first three sentences.
Yeah, it's weird.
So that's why I'm like, well, you know, I think I could act, but I'm not good at memorizing.
Yeah, I can memorize lines. It blows my wife's mind away. She's like, you forget to take out the trash,
yeah.
But you can memorize 3 pages of dialogue.
He's got his excuses already memorized,
too.
It's kind of like Rain Man
happened,
honey.
I was going to go and take out the trash, but this is what happened.
So, but it's weird, you know.
That's.
Oh, and getting back to everyone's question as far as female actress.
Yeah.
I have to say, here it goes.
All right. The Rolodex just came in.
Meryl Streep.
Good choice.
Meryl Streep. And that whole J-Lo thing, I just want to work with her. That's all.
I just want that booty.
Yeah. Hey, we're past that.
I want to work with her.
We're past.
Just to put it out there again in case J-Lo's people is listening.
You're good.
That's why we all said what.
Cool. I know.
I got you. I'll tell you right now, Sage will work with Tara Patrick and Charmaine Starr in a second, so.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't even have to pay me.
There you go.
Well, let's have...
I'll write the script.
Let's go ahead and go into some of the darker areas of your experiences as being an actor. What are some things that you've been through like, fuck, this is what it's about? Like the real ugly part, whether it has to do with behind the scenes substance abuse or like a character of a actor that you looked up to and like, oh my God, that person does this.
Probably just trying to keep yourself grounded. Don't get into the whole
oh, I'm in LA, I'm an actor.
Yeah.
You know.
Definitely.
You know,
I'm going to the learn some party hard after.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, if I don't go to this party and meet this person, it's not going to happen for me. It doesn't work like that.
Okay.
It might happen, but for the most part, it doesn't work that way. But living in LA for like 14 years, learned some hard lessons.
Is there a particular...
Found out who I was,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Is there a particular like experience that you went through, like, oh my God, I can't reveal who this person is, but it really showed me a dark side of Hollywood? Get that Rolodex spinning.
Just just watching people come out here or coming out to LA and them not being able to take care of what they need to take care of when they first came out
you
here.
You know what? You're reminding me of Muhammad Ali because they're ducking and dodging this question, man.
Am I? Okay. Say it again.
I want to know if there's someone that you experienced with during your acting time that, man, I really looked up to this person or a situation and, wow. That really shows a dark side of what Hollywood is.
Maybe something that opened your eyes to the truth of what you thought it was, but it really wasn't, and it was kind of crushing.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you, Isis, for the clarification.
Sorry.
No, not really. But I had, nah. But I do remember one experience.
Yeah.
That stays vivid in my mind till this day.
Okay.
I didn't pay my rent. And they changed the locks on me.
Hmm.
And now I'm like, oh, shit. What am I going to do?
Right.
What That's am I going to do? It's reality.
Yeah.
We want to know dirt on other people.
Yeah, you just want the National Enquirer. Yeah.
It's like when you go to Disneyland and you see Mickey Mouse on a smoke break. You're like, what the fuck? He smokes?
That's not a cigarette, Mickey.
Dirt. Dirt on someone.
Not on, you know, you
just
have to
one,
say
just one tad
no,
bit.
No names necessary.
You watched Snow White smoking some weed.
I've been on set. Let me give you an example. I've been on set before and walked into the girls' bathroom and saw an actor, very famous person in there
getting
a blowjob in the stall by a girl, and then the girl turned around and asked me, do you want to make an extra $200? And I was like, no, bitch.
Man, dirt.
And I know all of their names.
Well, Isis, you just put him on the spot because he can't beat that one.
I can't beat that.
That's not even a bad one. That's not even a bad one. I've had actors.
That's like
I've had actors email me and ask me all kinds of favors, and I've know girls that have done this with these people and this. I mean, everybody knows about Charlie Sheen. Come on now.
Yeah.
And the scandals and all that. We want to know something like that.
I think because he's a reformed family man, he wants to.
Maybe he just doesn't know anything.
No
maybe
comment.
Maybe he does.
Look at this handsome gentleman. You think he's
no comment.
Golden angel here? No,
well, now he's turning pretty red. Yeah, right about now.
I know.
His palms are sweaty. He's clammy as hell. His freaking karma earlier.
Yeah, exactly.
Can we get a? Can we
it
get
looks
a?
Looks like he's got sunburned right about now.
Can we get a? I'm not gonna say no names, but what had happened was
this one actor,
probably just a known actor, working actor.
Okay.
At a club one night, probably almost walking into a bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
Just straight cokehead.
Gotcha.
Same just, scenario.
Yeah.
I'm like, wow. I'm not going down that road.
Yeah.
That's not even my thing. You know,
that shit happens over in Walnut Creek.
You mean you don't go to the bathroom? You don't go to the bathroom at a club? Shame on you.
That football player walked into the club.
Well, we'll let
you
off.
Lindsay Lohan, did you?
Well, we're going to go ahead and go into our break, which is the mixed time with DJ D Skies. And maybe Manny will come up with an incredible story that he feels is more on the relaxed end that he could bring out coming out. So we'll be right back here on the Slam Show. Enjoy the mix time. Yeah, baby. Yeah.
Hold up, won't air. I just press this early in the morning. Is he on my mind? I'ma take the time. shot now. Hold up, 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 yeah, yeah.
She love the way I'm doing it, do it. So good she won't put my tattoo on it. Bottom line is, you the finest. Get you a new name. What's that, what's that, what's my b-? Hold up, hold up, won't air. Let's capture this moment. If I, then I own it. Wantin' every moanin' and patronin', girl, we groanin'. But that got me feelin' like a kid with the streetlights on.
Streetlights on, on.
You know I gotta go until it's early in the morning.
When she's all alone, I'ma take my time. Do it how we want, just to set the mood. Girl, I brought some water, yeah, and Chardonnay. So just let the song play.
Hold up, hold up, hold up, hold up, hold up, hold up, hold up. Talk to the man. You talking to a grown man. It's like wait, wait, way too much up in your pants for us not to make the bed squeak.
There goes the bitch.
Everybody rip the swag off before I rip the tag off. Why my pants sag off? Cause I'm rapping my ass off. Flow so ugly, money is so handsome. This the anthem, get it? The anthem.
Early in the morning,
yeah.
When she's all alone,
when she's all alone,
I'ma take my time. Do it how we want, just to set the mood. Girl, I brought some water, yeah, and Chardonnay. So just let the song play. The long way, the strong way, it's all day, it's always. This was all inspired by a little Marvin Gaye and Chardonnay.
Watching you like the hawk in the sky. I bring you on my way. Boy, I promise you, if we keep bumping heads, I know that one of these days we gon' pick it up. Probably talk on the phone, but see, I don't know if that's good. I've been holding back this secret from you. I probably shouldn't tell you.
Champagne ain't no face, ain't no name.
Drop that, drop that, drop that.
Swerve, put you toward the head. Swerve, 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 bounce. Single, seeing double, making triple, right? I hope you pay, never make a nickel, right? It's good to make it better when your people make it with you. Money coming, money going, ain't like you could take it with you. Right. It's about to be a hit right now. Back then with it right now. Drop, take care of all the motherfucking crib, and I'm picking up the keys to the beat right now. OVO, that's major. Toronto with me, that's major. Getting cheddar packs like KD. OKC, that's player. We don't dress alike, we don't rap alike. I shine different, I rhyme different. Only thing you got is some years on me, man. You and your time difference. I'm young, poppy. Champagne, they know the face and they know the name. Got one watch that could probably pay for like all your chains, so you don't be changed. Greystone, 20 bottles, that's all me. On the couch, wildin' out, gotta free my today I'm free. One of my close dogs, got three kids and they all three. But we always been that type of crew that been good without a plan B, so. Stop talking that and suckin' for some truck fit. Okay, I'm gone. That's gangsta Al Capone. I make that spit like bone. I'm talking about bone, 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 bone. I'm with French, excuse my French. I lose my mind before I lose my money in a thing but a chicken wing. I ball like two eyelids. YMCM beat that back. Yup, stop playing. I make her ever scream and holler like rock bands. I'm a beast, I'm off the lead. I am rich like a bee. On my pro, active shit. Pop that like a zip. I go by the name Lil Tunchi. Your girl is a groupie. And use a square. And I will twist you like an Rubik's mother. I'm on my skateboard. Watch me do a trick. I'm 5'5", but I can 6'9". Then beat that like Klitschko. It's French Montana, Joe. It's Weezy F. It's truck the world, it's truck your girl, it's truck pit by the truckload.
Long nights to get a payday. Finally got paid. now I need shade and a vacay. And sick and feel hating, so much hate, I need a AK. Now we I'm Perry, yeah, I'm Perry A-ing. White girls politicking, that's that Sarah Palin. Getting hot, Californicating. I give her that D, cause that's why I was born and raised in.
Okay, Lamborghini Mercy. Swerve. Yo, chick, she so thirsty. Swerve. I'm in that 2C Lambo. Swerve. With your girl, she tryna turn on me. Lamborghini Mercy. Swerve. Yo, chick, she so thirsty. Swerve. I'm in that 2C Lambo. Swerve. With your girl, she tryna me.
Maybe it's this ocean view. I'm so emotional and all these thoughts been dancing on my head. Too long, too long, too long. I wrote a song for you. I wanna sing to you, but every time I'm close to you, the words won't look come out, but I forget. It's so strong, it's so strong, it's so strong. Midnight scene.
Your friends. grew up with no daddy. I'm from Miami-Dade. Mount San check, ass can't cash. When Tam LeBron boss, D-Way fast. I can't forget that boy, U.D. Udonis has. I'm from Miami-Dade, count that born and raised ass. Mouth full of ghosts and diamonds, but talk is cheap. There's rules and codes in they county streets. Y'all break rules and codes to talk shit on beats. No that he walk at me, he though Miami will bring the heat. I'm self-made, I'm self-paid. I grew up with no daddy, I'm from Miami-Dade. I'm self-made, I'm self-paid. I grew up with no daddy, I'm from Miami-Dade. Welcome to Dade County. Welcome to Dade County. Welcome to Dade County. Welcome to Dade County.
I need a glow stick.
You feel sort of ghost glow stickish?
Glow stickish. Yeah.
Uh-oh. Welcome everyone to the Slam Show. That was the mix time with DJ D Skies, kicking it off with a very exclusive trap medley of good stuff. Thank you, Mr. D Skies, for the great mix. And we're gonna go right into our second part of the interview with special guest Manny Gavino.
What's up?
Let's talk about your hobbies besides acting. What do you like doing?
Basically, hobbies right now, just keeping fit, playing a lot of basketball, playing this great league in Sacramento called Fam Hoops. Straight props out to Ivan Dietz and Freddie Nonog for starting a great league and having me part of it. And definitely playing a lot of basketball keeps me sane, you know, as far as just like Isis was saying, you know, you got to balance everything out, you know,
gotta
as far
balance.
As especially for me, you know, now that I'm a husband, a daddy, and my career acting comes third now.
Right.
Those two come first and foremost. And, you know, just every day, just trying to keep it real. What you see is what you get. You know, I don't sugarcoat it for nobody. You know, either you like me or you don't. You know, I give respect to those who respect me, and you know, that's real.
Yeah, and you could basically, being in the industry, you could kind of see right through all the fake ones and the real people.
Yeah,
and,
you know,
and to a certain degree in Hollywood, do you have to kind of wear that cap of just going through the motions because you know it's a gig, even though it could be kind of sketchy who you're dealing with?
You know, you there's a game you got to play to a certain extent, but for the most part, you know, I just try to keep it real. You know, I ain't getting down on my knees just to get a job.
Right.
You know, I'm gonna be who I am. You know, like I said, you know, either like me or you don't. If you don't, just I guess move on. You know, but I just gotta keep it fucking real. That's how I am.
There you go, man. You know, throwing the cuss word. I love it.
That's real. You know.
I respect that. I respect it because a lot of people go to LA or get in the industry and change who they are as people. And you know, if you can't be you, then why?
Because a lot of times you see people in LA, oh, please give me a job, give me a job. Man, fuck that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, nah, I ain't playing that game. You know, let me have my audition. If you don't like me, oh, well, I'll move on.
Right. You know, so. And you were touching base on people that go into Hollywood and they find out the real deal, then they're right back to Idaho or where they came from.
A lot of times, you know, they don't handle their business. They get caught up in all the partying, all the coke. You know,
drugs.
Trying to rub elbows with people.
Right.
You know, it might happen that way, but for the most part,
shoulders.
It don't. You know, you get these. Yeah, exactly.
So right now, just be straight up, if you can, who that you see that's in Hollywood that's making a good name for themselves kind of went down on their knees or rubbed elbows and did it kind of shady to get where they're at? I know this kind of connects to the dirt thing earlier, but
basically give us some names.
I can't go there. Sitcom of a prominent network, this person, whatever.
Can we just hand him a shovel so he can just start digging?
I know.
Some shit here.
You're not off the hook, Isis. We got still your part to come up.
Well, I mean, you could also say, like, you know how the girls, you know, have to sleep with the producer or whoever's in charge to get the job. Is there any guy out there that you know I had to go down to some old bag to get the job?
There's some, you know, there's a lot of truth to that. You know, there's a lot of females out there.
Big old hairy gray bush.
There's a lot of fine females out there that are actresses or models or whatever, and they feel that if they're going to get with this old director, old producer, their career is going to be set.
Yeah.
It ain't happening.
Right, right.
What about a guy, like, although, for a female, like,
you know what,
producer?
It goes both ways. Goes both ways. You know, but I'm not going down that route, man. I you know. Plus, I'm married, man. I can't do that.
That's right, like, right.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you, you know, since you watched a lot of Friends, remember Joey was an actor.
Yeah.
He slept with one of the casting directors.
All the casting directors.
Right.
So you never did that for yourself?
I never did that. Okay. Never did that.
Okay.
Yeah, never did that. Can honestly say I never did that.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. You're not under the microscope or anything. You're just...
Oh, I know.
So,
look, I've slept with a lot of people, but never to get a job. So...
And that's
in, yeah,
quite clear.
That's very clear.
Yeah.
Well, Manny, thank you very much for being able to come on to the show, be very candid about your acting career, and best wishes on
best
furthering
of luck
it.
For everything.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Moving
again,
on to the future.
Once again, thank you all for having me. And like I said, Sam, much love to you, kid. Even when I took off for LA, like I said at the beginning of the show, you were still supporting me. You were still showing me mad love on my career. And I appreciate that. And I take that to the grave, man. That's that's on point, man. Thank
I appreciate, you. Appreciate the acknowledgement.
Yeah.
Stay humble. It's an amazing virtue, and people lose it along the way. And I can see it inside of you. You're a very humble man.
Thank you.
Very good man. And just don't ever lose it. Ever.
Thank you. Thank you.
And so right now we're just going to go ahead and turn the tables a bit. You'll be a co-host, and we're going to talk a little bit with Isis because she is a actress and director, and a lot of things are on her plate coming up.
Oh my God.
So, Isis, thank you very much
for
being able to hang out. Once again, you've been very supportive of the network, coming out to volunteering and stuff like that. And now you're kicking it with us for the second time since my birthday back in 2011.
So actually, it's the third time because we did the Harlem Shake.
We did the Harlem Shake.
That's true.
Actually, it's the fourth time because we did the food drive. So
that's right.
But before we start anything, can we just tell everybody about the next food drive so they can go
Absolutely.
And volunteer?
Absolutely.
Right? I want to say it's on the 24th of April.
Yeah.
In Concord.
In Concord, but make sure everyone contacts me because we have to make sure the numbers are correct.
Contact
we don't want 15,000 people showing up. So
contact Sam. I did it the last food drive with you guys, and it was amazing experience. Amazing people, just really good-hearted, and we got a lot of food out to a lot of people that needed it, and just go. And I mean, man, if you can take a day to catch up on all the shows that you missed, you can take a day out and go and, you know, feed people that need food, you know, help people out. Just
that's
do
right.
it. And it's a really good feeling.
That's right.
So,
and as far as the scheduling, you could go ahead and contact the Contra Costa Food Bank over in Solano and find what fits your schedule. And that way you could go ahead and work it within that, and you'll be all set. So much props. Isis for doing that.
Yeah, and they have workshops for kids too, so kids can understand what's going on with the food and where it's going also as well.
True.
Yeah.
True.
So
true. So it's always a beneficial thing when you're volunteering. That's
Definitely.
For sure. So, but yeah, overall, it's great that you're still continuing with your efforts, acting and directing. How's everything been? And has it? You know, it looks like the fan base is growing. Can't complain.
I can't complain. Everything's good. I took a long time off. I stopped shooting for a while, for a very long time, and just directed for probably after I stopped shooting, I directed for about a year after that. And then it's, you know, been 12 years in the industry, so I kind of took a little sabbatical. And
that's the word for it.
Sabbatical.
I love that word.
Yeah.
I took a sabbatical, and
that's for Friends.
I know.
I like hiatus. I like hiatus. Yeah.
I don't watch
it's
Friends.
It's a sabbatical. I'm on sabbatical.
I don't watch Friends. But I took some time and just kind of, you know, regrouped and thought about what I wanted to do and what my next step was and what the goals were in the future, and
right.
just kind of took a break. And it was definitely well, it was needed. It was very needed. And I feel good, and went back to school. I think I told you last time, did the whole personal training thing.
Went to
school for advanced sports nutrition. I have some clients that I train on a regular basis, and I feel really, really good. I lost a shit ton of weight training those clients. My trainer is now back from Guatemala, so I'm going to start training again in MMA, jiu-jitsu, and stand-up fighting, stuff like that.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
She's scared of you.
Well, shit, can I be your ring girl when you're fighting?
You could be my massage girl when I'm done. No, but I kind of took a break and
that was kind of late saying.
Yeah, I know. Wah, wah, wah. I kind of was trying to figure out what I want to do. I'm working with a couple people and building a couple businesses, one of them being a cam business. I cam right now, so I cam. I'm on Night Flirt, and you know, so people want to talk to me live, and you know, do whatever they want to do live.
Okay.
They can call me on Night Flirt, but I'm building my own website and working on my own projects. I don't really want to talk about them until they come into fruition. So that's kind of that. But I mean, it's been a good, I guess, vacation. I mean, how many people can say that they've been on vacation for a year? You know?
Hey, nothing wrong with that.
You know? And I've done some stuff. Still back for Kink. You know, a great friend of mine, Ariel X, is now directing Ultimate Surrender, which was one of the last things I was doing when I left there.
Mm-hmm.
And she had some knee surgery, so she asked me to come back and help her out. So I did that, and I was there, and I was like, damn, I miss this. And it was all, everybody's kind of, it felt really good. I can't explain it. I was like, oh, family. Oh, I've worked with you guys for like 9 years, 10 years, you know, and it just felt, it felt good to be back. So went back again, and another good friend of mine, Bobby Starr, is directing what used to be Wired Pussy, which is now Electro Sluts. And I went and kind of helped her do a little domination rigging thing on another one of her sets. And she asked me if I'd come back and direct a scene for her. So I'm really, really considering it. I really, really miss it. I really do.
Do it.
I know. I really do. I really miss it. But I also have been offered a few more mainstream things, and I've been offered some reality shows. And and I just kind of, I don't know really which direction I want to go now, because a lot of me wants to go mainstream, and a lot of me loves directing smut. So I don't know.
Hey, directing is your forte. Go for
it. I love directing.
Yeah,
I love it.
Would you direct Manny?
I would. I would.
I'm down.
I would. I would, because he's, like I said, he's humble, and he seems like a very easy person to work with, and he understands.
And that's the advantage right there. You don't have a rookie that's coming in that's just going to freaking have to learn the ropes, and you have to tolerate the mistakes.
He gets it. He gets it. Yeah.
That's cool.
But there's a part of me that I wish I was, okay, I wish I, what I know now.
Yeah.
Let me start again.
I'm sure.
I tell you that every day. It is like that.
You know.
Oh, believe me. I think in this profession, you're always going to search for perfection. And just like when I do remixes and stuff, I'll reflect after putting it out. It's in the stores. It's on radio. I'm like, fuck, I could have done a better job.
You're like, oh, I should have done that right there.
Yeah. But
it's the perfectionist in us.
Yeah.
It's just the way it is.
But at the same time, that was the moment where you thought it was good enough and you released it. And what else can you do?
Yeah.
It is what it is. And future projects, you'll just refine it and get better and hope that you'll be satisfied as is. Because I don't think we'll ever be satisfied with our work, because it's art.
No. Well,
it's just like the Mona Lisa, I'm sure.
Let me tell you, I've directed so many movies, hundreds and hundreds, and I can't even tell you how many I've directed. I mean, so many years of directing, you know?
Yeah.
And then been in so many movies as well. And people are always like, well, what's your favorite thing that you've ever done? And I'm like, fuck doll, Peyton Bell. That's my favorite. Fuck doll, Peyton Bell. For Wired Pussy, fuck doll, Peyton. It's like my all time favorite, because it was so twisted and so off the wall and really just kind of fucked up. And
wait, can you say that slowly? What was the title again?
Fuck doll.
Okay.
Wired Pussy, Fuck Doll with Peyton Bell and Isis Love.
Oh, that's the
one more time, please.
It was really kind of fucked up, and we kind of shot it on a fly. Like, I had an idea. It was one of those times where I didn't write anything out, and I didn't really know what I wanted to shoot, and I didn't know her, really. Mm-hmm. And I met her while she was in makeup, and I was like, okay. And I went downstairs with my crew, and I was like, this is how I want the set to look. And they had basically 2 hours to get it done how I wanted it and make it look super creepy. And, man, they banged it out, and the lighting was just amazing. And I told her, I was like, look, this is what's going to happen. You're going to be a doll, and I'm going to, it's, you know, all electric torture, and I'm going to tie you up and basically turn you on with all these electric torture devices and put batteries inside of you, and you're going to kind of come to life, you know?
Literally.
Literally. It was fucked up. It was probably the one of the most fucked up shoots I've ever done. And it actually inspired me to go home and write a short film. And I sat up all night. I went home and I wrote out a film. Non-adult, no porn, nothing. Mm-hmm. Just I sat at home and wrote out a whole short film.
Wow.
Right after that. It was really kind of twisted.
Well, so sometimes the sources of inspirations come out of the weirdest place.
Oh, man, it was weird. Like, I probably should have went home and cried. Like, most normal people would have gone home and go, my God, I can't believe I just did that. It was so wrong. And I was like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. And then the mom dies. And then the dad takes this out of the box. And then it was just, like, really, it was really, really twisted. Really twisted. But on another note, before I forget, huge news, Public Sex, Private Lives documentary that they've been shooting for 4 years, mm-hmm. that it's myself, Princess Donna, and Lorelei Lee, shot by Simone Jude. We did a Kickstarter for it, you know?
Good.
And we...
Just like for the lingerie team.
Exactly. We did a Kickstarter, and people that donated, I think $2,500, got to go on dinner date with me. Ah! But we raised well over the asking amount. And we have it in post-production, and it's actually had a few private screenings recently, but it just got accepted to be in the San Francisco Documentary Festival.
Oh,
so,
wow.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So, yeah, so our documentary is coming out, Public Sex, Private Lives. Go online, Public Sex, Private Lives, watch the trailer.
Good stuff.
And when it comes out at the San Francisco Doc Festival, come out and see it.
All right.
I'll be there.
Cool.
Sam's already got a bootleg copy of it.
No, nobody has it.
He has Avengers 2 already.
Avengers 2.
We have Grunky in the chat room. He asks, do you have any shoots or actors or actresses you want to direct or pursue?
Wait, mainstream or not mainstream?
I guess across the board, both.
Shoots that I've... Okay, wait, ask me that question again. That's like 4 questions in one.
Well, I'm just... reading what he's writing, but basically he's saying, is there anyone that you want to direct that's in the industry?
That's in the industry? I've kind of directed everybody. Fuck, 9 years. Honestly, if there was somebody that I could direct, I'd have directed everybody.
What about mainstream actors that you say you just want to do a regular movie?
Oh, that's different. I'd love to put Scarlett Johansson in a really, really...
Oh, that's Karma's
hot
fave.
Hot movie.
See?
Yeah, a really...
I'm not an idiot.
I'd love to write something with her
in
mind as a lead character, because she just oozes everything.
You hear that, Karma?
Sex and ooze.
Someone hacked her email account. You heard about her pictures.
I'm saying...
So
she's
hot. You know,
she's a good actress.
She's going to be open to ideas. If she's got her own pictures of herself.
There you go. So go ahead and do a call out right now for Scarlett Johansson. Look straight into the camera.
Scarlett Johansson? I don't even know the camera. I want you in my next film.
Right on. Perfect.
So there's other things. I mean, I write normal screenplays. And mm-hmm. a friend of mine, Balance, and I, we have written... we wrote Tunnels, which is a screenplay, and we've also started working on... I've been working on Old Man Withers for like a billion years, which is like a kid's movie, which is crazy. And I just started working on one called The Lot. So Cool. That one, I'm hoping to get that one out first. So
right on.
Hopefully. We'll see.
Cool. And if anyone wants to follow you, what is your Instagram, Twitter, and all that good stuff?
Instagram, Isis Love. Twitter, Isis Love. I do not have a Facebook. All the Facebooks out there are fake, which is horrible. And I feel sorry for everybody that thinks they're talking to me on Facebook. But it's not me. I'm actually very, very social and very personable. And I actually talk to people back and comment. And I meet people. And if I'm out on the street or the club or the restaurant, don't be afraid of me. I'm not going to hurt you. I hurt people on film. I don't hurt people in real life unless they ask me to.
Well said.
Karma's waiting.
Exactly.
Get a battery in your hand there.
Yeah. No donkey punching allowed.
That's too much. All right.
What the hell have you been watching?
your short films, dude. Karma's Corner.
All right. Well, we're going to go ahead and roll into our shouts and plugs since we're kind of cutting close on time. And as we always do, we start off with the lovely Lady Sage.
Thank you very much. Well, first and foremost, shout outs to our guests, Manny Gavino and Isis Love. You guys are wonderful actors in so many different ways, but almost the same. So good luck with your future endeavors. And I know, Isis, you have a lot of projects, so good luck to you.
And now I have the lingerie league that I got to set up.
Oh, my God.
The lingerie.
Lingerie.
I don't even have to try out, right? I'm already in the league.
No, you're in.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. That's freaking awesome. And, of course, to my present crew, Slam and Sam, Karma, and DJ Stallion. And to all of our sponsors and affiliates, a shout out to you guys. And drinkwearclothing.com will be having a booth at the car show on Sunday at the Excelsior Way in Sacramento. So check them out. And if you want a complete list of our sponsors, go to tvepn.com. And if you're interested in being our sponsors or affiliates, contact Slam at contact@tvepn.com.
Yeah, yeah. Mr. Tony, take it away. Yes, it's you.
I got called out.
Okay, Samuel. Lady Sage, Samuel Jackson, Sam, Maxie, and Sammy. Karma, special guest, Manny, and Isis, thanks for coming out, guys. Our sponsors, Kinders, Drinkware.com, BPMSupreme.com, Zion's Energy, Davino's, Spelton's Wine, Natural Life Foods, Dickie's Barbecue, Perfect Tan, Niner Empire, Online Listening, Savage, Pistol Pete, and my parents.
Well.
Hello, Mom and Dad.
Yes. Hi, Mama.
Shout out, parents.
Oh, yeah.
Mr. Karma.
So, for DJ Stallion, Lady Sage, Slam and Sam, thank you for letting me sit in my corner as always. Manny, good luck in the future. Can't wait to see your work in the future. And obviously, Icy's, can't wait to see your work as well.
You always watch my work.
Yeah, you do. That's why you're always late.
I would. I don't have Wi-Fi in here yet.
You don't need Wi-Fi.
Manny, take it away.
Like I said before, everybody in this room, thank you for showing me straight mad love, friends for life. Also want to send a special shout out to my wife, Angeline, Nevaeh, my daughter. I love you. Daddy be home soon. Also my boy, Mark McKeon, who I play hoops with, and also my boy, James Swift, who just won the championship fam hoops at Arco Arena.
Ooh.
Or Sleep Train, whatever they're calling it these days. fam league owners, who invented the league, Freddie Nonog, Ivan Diaz, thanks for having me. And to everyone out there listening, live life.
Right on. And for if sure. anyone wants to follow you, what's the best way?
Facebook, find me. Right? Facebook me.
Find me.
We're setting this guy up on Instagram.
See, because of these two lovely ladies, I got to set up my Instagram. And
no excuses.
Get my Manny Gavino Jr., however I'm calling myself these days, .com going on.
It's going on tonight, guys. It's starting here on the Slam
Show. There you go.
It's going on now.
All right. Isis?
For sure. You know, shout out to everybody out there and all the followers and fans and friends and my peeps who keep me going, keep me alive, keep food on my plate, honestly, because if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be here. And, you know, to share my love to the world. Thank you guys for having me. Thanks for having me on multiple occasions, not just on air, but to do, you know, the random stuff and help people out, because I really, really do love that. And kink.com, even though I'm not there really anymore because I left. I still do go back and I still love them. So shout out to kink.com. And then Sexually Broken is one of the websites that I just recently worked with. And shout out to them for having me. And my mentor, Matt Williams, taught me how to rig, taught me everything I know.
Matt Williams. Okay.
Matt Williams.
Not the former third baseman of the Giants.
No, everybody. Everybody thinks that's him. But no. Yeah, Matt Williams. What's funny, because he used to play baseball also.
That's crazy.
But he taught me everything I know. He was my bondage coach, I guess.
Okay. So, or bondage mentor.
My bondage mentor. Exactly. I was his young Padawan. So.
Anakin.
So shout out to him. Shout out to my family who support me in everything I do. And honestly, my friends that keep me strong and let me know that, you know, there's good people out in the world. And the judgment is rare these days. But
judgment can only be made by God.
Exactly, by God. And you know, I mean, I go through a lot of stuff because of what I've done and what I do and what I've, you know, everything. But I really appreciate the love and honesty and respect that I get from my friends and my family, and I know who's really there. And Public Sex, Private Lives, San Francisco documentary, the film festival. Watch it. You can learn all about me. Like, the real, real, real me follows me at home, follows me at work. You guys can see what it's all about. Not just me, but Laura Lily and Princess Donna. So
there you go. Mm.
Good stuff.
And what are the sites to follow you and reach you at?
Like I said, Instagram, Isis Love, Twitter, Isis Love, Isis Love Tumblr. That's for the raunchier stuff.
Ooh. The Tumblr stuff.
The Tumblr stuff.
As name.
Tumblr.
It sounds like a whole new like genre, right?
That's something I don't want to get into.
Yeah, that's just kind of more risque.
Risque.
And... shit, man, I don't know what else. Where else can you find me? Everywhere. I mean, look, it's my URLs. Isis Love, shout out to them. They build me a profile, verified me, and I'm going to be posting all my stuff on there.
Cool.
So if you want to find Isis Love anything, just go to it's my URLs, Isis Love. Really, honestly.
That's it. Or Google Isis Love.
Or Google Isis Love. Hey.
Plain and simple.
Yeah. Google me, bitches.
There might be a lot of fake stuff out there, so if you want the real Isis Love stuff, just follow the It's My URLs links.
Exactly.
That's
exactly.
All me.
Well done, guys. All right. I'll go ahead and close out the shouts. I'd like to thank my entire crew, Lady Sage, DJ Stallion, Mr. Karma, our special guest, Manny Gavino, and Isis Love. Thank you very much for having the time to spend with us.
Yes.
I'd like to thank all the network insiders and also our mixed time DJ, DJ D Skies. Thank you very much. The sponsors and affiliates out there, without you guys, there is no TV EPN, there is no Slam Show, so thank you. Special shouts to everyone in the chat room, and there's a bunch of names, too many to point out, but thank you for your dialogue, and also the ones that aren't in the chat room, that are just anonymous and don't want anyone to see what their little late night happenings are. Keep on doing your late night happenings.
Creeper.
We want that.
Creeper status.
And be sure to like our Facebook page at TVEPN The Slam Show, because this will automatically get you in our weekly drawing, which we are doing right now. So without further ado, I will give the bowl to I'll give it to you, Isis, first, and have Manny shake it, and then you'll pull out.
Yeah.
Literally.
Wait, who's pulling out, Manny?
Oh, can we just remind everyone again, Wednesday at Panetta's.
Yeah, Panetta's.
Wednesday night, Panetta's. Come out,
Pittsburgh Sports Bar. It's going to be happening. No cover, 21 and over. Good
do
times.
Your thing, girl.
I'm going to stick my whole hand in here.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I'm going to just work it around.
That's a big bowl.
Find something good. Oh, I think I found something. I'm going to pull it out.
Breathtaking.
Oh. Phil Savage.
Phil Savage. Congratulations. Wow.
Yeah. Congratulations, Phil Savage.
That's such a porn name.
Yeah, I was going to say Mark Savage. I was like, oh, he's going to be so excited.
Phil Savage. Congrats.
Congratulations. And once again, all you have to do is like our page to be automatically included in our weekly drawing. All right, guys, that does it for this episode
Real quick.
Yeah.
I just want to say something. I have this little quick announcement I wanted to make.
Oh, right. Oh.
Sorry, I want to wait last minute. Just want to say goodbye to everybody. This is going to be my last show because of some personal things I'm going through. You know, we've discussed before. So
okay.
I wanted to thank everybody and say goodbye.
All right. You know, so.
All the best, kid.
I'm not liking this news.
Dude, he's been acting kind of different all night.
So. All the best, Karma.
Yeah. All right.
We're April Fools.
Thank God. Oh, fucking God.
He got me.
Yeah.
I got gotten.
Oh, we all got gotten on the air.
Oh, man. That's
Sage
a good one.
Sage almost died.
My love, y'all. My love.
Yeah. Peace out, y'all.
We'll see you guys next week.
Peace. Next Monday.